A very good morning. The Lord be with you. Welcome to St. John's, particularly if you're relatively new or if you're joining us on the live stream, a very special welcome to you. And if you're visiting as well, a very warm welcome. Just going to go through a couple of brief notices. The first one is to say that it's our harvest celebration next week. We are going to have a bring and share lunch afterwards. There is a sign-up form if you're going to be able to come to that. So do write your names on that and anything that you can bring, and we'll put all the food out there and have some lunch afterwards. If you want to bring any donations, they'll be going to the Stowmarket and Area Food Bank. No fresh produce, please, but any kind of long-lasting kind of tins and packets of pasta and stuff. And we'll collect those in probably the second hymn and bring them up to the front there. That's harvest. Also, just a reminder that there is a deanery confirmation service coming up on the 22nd of October. If anyone is interested in being confirmed and hasn't had a word with me yet, do have a word with me afterwards. It's a special service this morning. We're thinking about, we called it Eco Sunday. We're thinking about creation care. And I'm just going to start with a psalm to orientate us. I will in a moment. I'll switch the on button. Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortal men who cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them, the Lord who remains faithful forever. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the alien and sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the ways of the wicked. The Lord reigns forever. Your God, O Zion, for all generations, praise the Lord. We are here this morning to praise the Lord, our wonderful maker of heaven and earth. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, thank you that we can gather together. Thank you that we can praise your name, and thank you for this glorious world which you have given us. As we think about creation care today, be with each one of us. And help us now to lift our hearts in adoration to you. Amen. And our first song of praise is Bless the Lord, O My Soul.
Yes. end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul sings your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like
Father, we do worship your holy name and thank you for all your blessings that you pour out on us. We praise you this morning. Amen. We're going to continue. If you have a hymn book, it's 367, My Jesus, My Saviour.
My comfort, my shelter.
Well, do sit down. Just a special hello to people joining us online again. We've had a few people have said hello, so hello this morning to Mark, Jane and Pat. Thank you for joining us this morning, and welcome to other people who haven't actually said hello. You're very welcome. Please pick up the blue service cards and we're going to say this prayer of preparation together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We're reminded this morning how God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So let us now confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. And so we pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we have our special prayer for today, the collect, and I thought it really is appropriate to Eco Sunday. I seem to have lost it. What have I done with that? Let me just check if it's on the screen. Otherwise, I'll... I forgot to put it on the screen. Sorry about that. But it is very appropriate. Let me lead us in that. Lord of creation, whose glory is around and within us, open our eyes to your wonders, that we may serve you with reverence and know your peace at our life's end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Is a lovely prayer. The Lord of creation, whose glory is around and within us. We're going to hear our first Bible reading now. Carol is going to come and read it to us.
The reading is taken from Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 to 31. And can be found on page 4 of your pew Bible. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along to the ground." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground." Then God said, "I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth, and all the birds of the air, and all the creatures that move on the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it. I give every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Sorry. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We're going to sing again now, All Creatures of Our God and King, and the words will be led by Ovidio. So let's stand and sing. Please remain standing, and Carol's going to bring our gospel to us.
The reading is taken from Matthew 25, verses 35 to 40, and can be found on page 995 of your pew Bible. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. This is the word of the Lord.
Well, please do sit down. We come to our sermon now, and I'm delighted to introduce Andy Mellon. Andy has spoken to us once before, and he and Liz are frequent visitors here. But Andy is the, let me get this right, you're the councillor for Mid-Suffolk, is that right? The Mid-Suffolk councillor, and a member of the Green Party, and passionate about creation care, as well as the Lord Jesus. I think, is that a fair introduction? That's good. So delighted that Andy's going to be speaking to us today.
Thank you, Peter. It's great to have this opportunity to speak to you this morning on this Eco Sunday. As Peter said, my name's Andy Mellon, and some of you know me, and my wife Liz and I have been coming here fairly regularly over the last year or so. And some of you know that I represent Elmswell actually as your county councillor here. I'm also on the district council, and in fact, since the local elections in May, I lead the district council. You probably know the district council does things like it collects your rubbish, it deals with environmental health, it looks after planning applications, a whole load of different things like that. That's what my day job is basically now, is looking after and running the district council. But I'm not here to talk about politics, either national or local. I'm going to steer very well clear of that this morning. But I am going to talk about the environment, and whilst the environment, I think, is a political issue, I'm going to explain why I think it's also a spiritual issue. So, no politics this morning, but having said that, if your bin hasn't been empty this week, come and see me afterwards. Now, I was born here in Suffolk, not in this area, but in the other side of Ipswich, a place called Martlesham. I'm sure people will know that where that is. It's where the BT building is. If you drive along the A12, you will see that. Once voted Britain's third ugliest building. Anyway, I was born and I grew up in old Martlesham, not the new bit by the BT building. And I grew up on what was my grandfather's farm. It was at the end of a lane, and the farmhouse overlooked a lovely little valley with a stream at the bottom. And across the valley, there was a kind of wood on the other side on the hill. And my brothers and myself and my sister, we used to run around and play in the stream and play in the wood. And it was just a lovely, peaceful place to grow up. Now, that all changed in the 1980s when a dual carriageway was built right through that valley. They carved a massive swathe through the wood. They worked for months with bulldozers, and they built up an embankment, and they cut a sort of cutting through the hill, and the whole thing looked very, very different. And if those of you who remember driving through Martlesham back in many years ago, it used to get very snarled up. We'd have all sorts of traffic jams because it was the first bit of single track road you came to after London. If you left London and were going up to the coast, Martlesham was the first bit that wasn't dual carriageway. And obviously the government in the end decided to build a bypass round the village. So now if you go to Woodbridge and you go up on your way to Oldborough, you basically drive through that valley, you drive through my grandfather's farm, and you won't see it, you won't even notice it's there. And I think that moment, the building of that road was when kind of I woke up to what I'm calling environment issues. It suddenly brought home to me that alongside getting this lovely new road and dealing with the traffic jams, And this development and this progress was also an element of destruction. You know, many hundreds of trees were cut down, big changes to the landscape, and the peace was replaced by the noise of cars and lorries and the pollution which came from them. And looking back, that was when I started to think much more about these issues. I wasn't any kind of eco-warrior. I didn't glue myself to a tree or lie down in front of the bulldozers. But I started to think, and as a young Christian, you know, I was only a teenager at the time, I started to wonder what God thought about this sort of thing. Did the Bible have anything to say about the environment? And in the years since then, this is an issue that's become very close to my heart. Something I've been following and studying, and I've talked on it and I've written over it, on it over many years. And something that in that time I think has become, in some ways, the dominant issue of our times. So what I want to do this morning is just briefly look at the subject of caring for the environment and see what the Bible might have to say about it. But before we look at some Bible verses, three quick things. Firstly, one of the problems with talking about a subject like the environment is it can all get very judgmental. So I just want to say very clearly, I'm not here to point the finger this morning. I'm not going to be passing a basket along to collect up your car keys. There will be no questionnaire to measure how green you are. And that's at least because I don't think my own lifestyle lives up to any kind of close scrutiny on these issues. You know, I'd love to tell you that I cycled here whilst wearing a recycled hair shirt, but that's not true. So I'm not aiming to make you feel guilty, but hopefully to make folks aware. And secondly, another reason Christians sometimes shy away from environmental issues is that they're seen as political and not spiritual. And of course, environmental issues are political ones, and that's what I do in my day job. But if we look back through the recent history of the church, we could look at a whole load of other issues like slavery, like racism, poverty, social injustice, and all of these issues that have at one time or another been ignored by Christians and the church as being political. But in the end, the church has to turn around and face up to them and work out a response in the light of what the Bible has to say. And a third reason I think that Christians sometimes haven't been worried about the damage to the environment is because we realise there's a problem, but sometimes we don't think it applies to us. You know, surely if we believe in Jesus, we're saved. We get a ticket to the party in the sky when we die. You know, yes, climate change and environmental destruction, they're happening, but hasn't God told us that the earth is going to pass away anyway? And he'll create a new heaven and a new earth. So you don't need to worry about the old one. You know, some Christians will even say that climate change is a sign that Jesus is coming soon. And we should welcome it and almost encourage it. And certainly we don't need to make any changes in our lives to try and avoid it. To me, that kind of thinking, I think, stems from a misunderstanding of how God will wrap things up at the end of time. If we do want to get our thinking straight on this, we need to get our theology straight. In our understanding of what God says in the Bible. Let's do that. Let's do a quick whistle stop of the key passages in the Bible as they relate to this topic. Now, we heard Carol read earlier in our first reading, right at the beginning of the Bible, in the first chapter of the book of Genesis, we have that creation narrative, and we read that as God created the world, he blesses what he's made, and he empowers it to develop, to be fruitful, to multiply and change. And he loads it with potential for the future. And right into the middle of creation, God puts man and woman, mankind. And he gives them responsibility for the rest of creation. I'll just read that verse again from Genesis 1. God created human beings. He created them godlike, reflecting God's nature. He created them male and female. God blessed them. Prosper, reproduce, fill earth, take charge, be responsible for fish in the sea and birds in the air, for every living thing that moves on the face of the earth. So while God hands responsibility over to Adam and Eve, the scene is set for mankind as the pinnacle of his creation to be in charge. But ruling over the rest of creation does not mean lording it over everyone else or recklessly using up creation for our own good. What is meant here is a gentle stewardship of the earth. It's God's earth, but we are given responsibility for it. Now we don't have a kind of a calendar or a time scale on the story of Adam and Eve. But what we see if you read a bit further into Genesis is man and woman living in harmony, both with God and with the created environment around him. So when man sins and turns away from God and that relationship gets broken, we don't just lose that kind of closeness with God, we also lose that relationship with the earth, with creation. That gets broken as well. So in a sense, that's the heart of what's gone wrong. Our brokenness and failure as a human race is seen not just in broken relationships with God and with people and with countries, but also in a broken relationship between us and creation and a failure to care for what God has put into our keeping. So that's my first point. The Bible tells us that God has called us to be stewards of creation. And the second point is about justice. Now, the Bible tells us that God loves justice, and we can read that right through the Bible, in the laws that he sets in place in the Old Testament, in the prophets who cried out for justice, and of course, more often in the words of Jesus. Now, we as a church are committed to care for the poor around the world. You know, we're linked with other places in the world to help people in practical ways, and we heard something of that last week when the lady from Tear Fund was here to speak. And we do this because it's a clear command in the Bible. You know, we show God's love to the needy. You know, and Jesus told his followers in that verse that we heard that when we help someone, it's as if we're doing it for Jesus directly. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. So those are Jesus' words. But if that principle is true, we need to apply that kind of principle to the whole environment too. Because it's clear that global warming and other environmental problems affect the poor disproportionately more. And we see that already when disaster strikes. It's always the poor who are worse off because they're far more vulnerable than we are. You know, every year we hear about things like hurricanes striking in Florida and places like that. And yes, there's lots of damage and a few people tragically are killed. In December 1998, a hurricane hit Honduras and Nicaragua, two poor countries in Central America. And because of their vulnerability, it wasn't just a few people that died. It was 11,000 lives that were lost. And the development of those countries was set back by decades. So the poor are much more vulnerable than we are in the developed Western countries. So what about the future? Climate change is going to cause sea levels to rise, and it's the millions of people who live in places like Bangladesh and India who will feel the problem most acutely. It's the subsistence farmers in Africa who will starve when climate change makes the rains fall. It's the shantytown dwellers whose homes get washed away when there's intense storms. It's those at the bottom of the pile who Jesus said we should care for, who suffer and go hungry when climate change affects agricultural production and food prices start to rise. And that's already happening. We've seen that on the news over the last year. We often talk about the gospel being good news. That's what it means. That's what the word means. And we talk about it being good news for the poor. But climate change is not good news for the poor. In fact, it's devastatingly bad news for the poor. And if we care for them, as Jesus told us, we can't be part of the problem that makes their lives worse. So we talked about stewardship and we talked about justice for the poor. And my third point is that about the redemption that comes through Jesus. Now, probably the most famous verse in the Bible is John chapter 3, verse 16. We're probably all familiar with that, which it's supposed to sum up the whole gospel in one verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. But we often think about that verse and what Jesus did on the cross as being just about kind of our personal salvation, you know, about my sins being forgiven and about me being right with God. And that's correct, it is about that. But I think those words, for God so loved the world, tell us that salvation is so much wider than just about us. God loves this world. God loves this world, and we can see it in the skill and loving craftsmanship that he used, in the beauty and the diversity of creation, and the sheer wonder of what he has made. God takes joy in creation. And so God's plan of redemption is not just about reconciling people to himself. It's also about the renewal and restoration of the whole of creation. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 8 that creation will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into freedom and glory. So when we pray, as we do every week in the Lord's Prayer, and I'm sure we'll do this a little bit later, we pray these words: your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That means we're not just waiting for the day when Jesus returns. We are called to be part of bringing God's kingdom into place in the here and now. That means stewardship. That means justice. And that means renewal and restoration. So when we personally care for creation, when we choose to live lightly on the planet, when we live simply so that others can simply live, we are part of that redemption. We are a sign of God's kingdom here on earth. I think it's only in the last few years, as we've kind of started to realise, you know, how enormous the problem of environmental damage is, and we've started to realise that it's us who's causing it, the kind of full meaning of this responsibility God has given us has become clear. We never meant for climate change to happen. We never intended to damage creation, but because of that broken relationship between mankind, God, and creation, it has happened. And now that we're aware of it, and we're aware of the consequences of how we live, we have to decide what practical steps we're going to take to somehow regain that role as good stewards of creation. Now, I'm not going to go into the practicalities of that today, because that's a whole another sermon, maybe even a series of sermons. But what I think is true is that mankind faces a huge problem in climate change, together with pollution and all the other things, destruction of the rainforest and all the things we're aware of. However, God has given us awesome ability and creativity and the capacity to solve problems and to change our behaviour. And we can, with God's help, make a difference in this world. God's redemption plan through Jesus is not just here so we can escape to heaven when we die. We are here on earth to declare his kingdom and be his people and to be part of that redemption here and now, redeeming both people and the planet back to him. And I know lots of people in our country and in the world are in despair about the problem of environmental change and destruction. I'm very, very worried about the state of the planet. We as Christians have hope. We have a living hope that can turn despair into joy. So let's encourage one another. Let's pray for one another so that our lives speak of God's love for his people and for his creation. Amen.
I was reminded of a few words from Psalm 98. We sometimes sing a version of it here. And just thinking about the redemption of creation and how creation feels about the Lord coming, I'll just read a couple of verses. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. I just love that picture of creation breaking out in praise, the rivers and the mountains. I'm just going to turn the volume down on me. We're trying hard here at St John's to be a bit more environmentally friendly. There's a few things that we don't always get right, but we try to. One of the things that we try to do, if you're not aware, is we try not to have disposable plastic cups in the kitchen. I know there's a couple still in there, but we're going to use them up. We don't really want them replaced with more plastic cups. We either want reusable cups or biodegradable cups or recyclable cups. Likewise, plates and so on. So just if you're ever doing an event here at St John's, please don't buy anything that isn't that's not eco-friendly. You'll notice that down the end of the churchyard, we often leave that grass a bit longer. We try to encourage wildflower for the bees and things. So we are trying to make a bit of an effort here, and I'm sure we can all at home. I think we're just going to stay seated for the next song. During lockdown, we obviously produced a lot of recordings of songs, and Caroline Long did a beautiful version of Indescribable with really, really great words. So we're going to enjoy that now.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colours of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Imagine the sun and give source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God.
Shall we stand together and say the words of the Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please sit or kneel for our prayers. So let us pray to the Lord together. How wonderful, Lord, are the works of your hands. The heavens declare your glory. The arch of the sky displays your handiwork. In your love, you have given us the power to behold the beauty of your world in all its splendor, and the authority to care for your wonderful creation. Holy Maker of the universe, thank you that you created us in your image and have breathed life into us. Thank you that you have given us a world rich in resources. Remind us that we are but stewards, and so help us to act responsibly, not wasting or destroying what we do not need, not polluting the earth or sea or sky, but that we may act with love towards all things and so reflect the great love that you have for the world. Teach us to respect all your works, to care for your creatures and your world, and to praise you in all that we do. So, Father, creator of all things, we commend to you this day and ourselves and all that we will do. Be with us, Lord God, creator of all. Strengthen us that we may share in the love and care for your world. And Father, be with the governments of the world as they seek to tackle climate change. We ask for you to enable politicians to see the urgency of this problem, to take it seriously and not to allow short-term politics to deflect the investment and solutions we need to reduce harmful emissions. We thank you for the huge strides forward being made by scientists and researchers in renewable power. And we pray for your continued guidance for all involved in this work. And Lord, we pray for areas of conflict in our world. We continue to pray for the Ukraine, asking for the withdrawal of Russian troops, for a lasting peace to be established. We pray for the area of Nagorno-Karabakh, for the thousands of civilians who are now without shelter. We pray that aid will be allowed to get through. And we just pray against another genocide happening. And we pray for other places of war like Yemen. Please comfort all those who have lost loved ones or who are suffering as a consequence of war or military action. Prince of Peace, we pray for reconciliation and harmony in your world. And we pray for those in need more locally, for those struggling with debt. Be with our food banks and care workers. We pray for you to be with those who are bereaved, especially we remember the family of Pam Green this morning. And for those who are sick or poorly, let's have a moment of silence to name them now, quietly before the Lord. Father, heal the sick, comfort the bereaved, uplift the downcast, and give your resurrection hope to us all. We thank you for the Lord Jesus coming to take our sin upon himself, so that we might be set free and live for you for all eternity. In Jesus' name, we pray all these things. Amen. We're going to sing number 309, King of Kings, Majesty. Please do sit down. And we come now to what we call the Eucharistic prayer. Eucharistic just simply means thanksgiving. We're giving thanks as we come to share the bread and the wine together. And just a reminder that we are offering the two options. If you would like just the wafer to be dipped, just point slightly towards me. If you'd like to receive the chalice, just kind of indicate to Gavin and we'll know which way to go once you've received the wafer. And of course, if you just want to receive a wafer, just indicate that as well. So the Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty God, good Father to us all, your face is turned towards your world. In love you gave us Jesus, your Son, to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home, to the city where angels sing your praise. We join with them in heaven's song. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Father of all, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. To the darkness, Jesus came as your light. With signs of faith and words of hope, he touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. This is his story. The crowds came out to see your son, yet at the end they turned on him. He came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. This is his story. Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body, given for you all." Jesus then gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup and gave it and said, "This is my blood shed for you all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." This is our story. Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us and all the world. This is our story. Send your spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with opened eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all who share this food offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. We pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Jesus is the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word and I shall be healed. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Let's pray together the sending out prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Well, we come to our closing hymn. All the words are on the screen again. It is number 396, so if you'd rather have a hymn book. We made this recording, if you remember, when we were in lockdown one, we did a Songs of Praise. We did it all online. So we put together various images with this wonderful song, which again focuses on the great creation that the Lord has given us. Let's stand and sing, How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. My Savior God, to thee,
watching that, I really don't know whether to just praise God for a wonderful creation or say, praise God, that lockdown is over. It was a terrible time, wasn't it? Please do stay behind for a cup of tea or coffee. But now, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among us and remain with us always. Amen. So let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen.